Hello, everyone. Heather Holmes here with KTVU Fox 2 News, the San Francisco Bay Area. And joining me today is Dr. Rashid Chotani. He is medical officer at IEM and someone that we've been talking to now for several months about COVID-19. He's an infectious disease expert. And Dr., thanks again for taking the time to talk with us.
Thank you. It's always good to be with you and to talk about such an important subject that we are dealing with right now.
Yeah, and continue to be dealing with, especially there at the White House. Let's talk about this outbreak that has now infected more than 24 people.
First of all, let me say that, myself and, I believe the whole nation is very happy that the president is doing better. And it looks like he's out of danger, although, there is still a chance of, the infection taking something. But he's been treated with a lot of things and he's doing better, which is a good thing. Right now, the outbreak at the White House, initially it was thought that there were about 24 contacts, aides and contacts who had contracted the disease. But it seems that the numbers have increased right now, according to a report that just came, memo that just got out of FEMA, that about 34 people that have been infected at the White House. They have started a robust contact tracing program at the White House, which is led by the medical unit at the White House, as well as CDC integration. And the integration part means that there is an epidemiologist from the CDC who's been detailed to the White House since March, who's taking over this investigation and looking at all the contact tracing there.
Given though what we know about the number of people infected, what does that tell you about how this virus is spreading there at the White House?
So as we, as from last week when we talked about it, I said one case in a given area represents an outbreak. So yes, it is an outbreak and it has spread and the disease has spread quite a bit in that particular bubble. They're taking all sorts of precautions over there. There are things that are being done over there that probably are not being done anyplace else in terms of the precautions that are being taken, infection control practices, et cetera. But what this means is that this virus can attack anybody, any place, irrespective of how secure you feel. It can attack you and it can cause devastation in that particular group of people. Right now, the former governor of New Jersey is in the hospital. Who also contracted the disease. There are a few other people that might have to end up in a hospital. Now, the question is, how are we going to deal with all of that? How is that group going to deal with it as, the disease spreads as well as, in some cases, causes serious disease?
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about the president and the treatment during his, as he's being treated for COVID-19. There is this experimental drug, and there is a lot of, talk about it. Could it be effective? Could it be, distributed widespread? Your thoughts on this drug and the fact that now it looks like it's going to seek emergency use authorization.
So the president received multiple drugs, including the monoclonal antibody, remdesivir, dexamethasone, another drug, which is essentially an antacid given at a very high dose. All of these drugs have been in studies or trials. Remdesivir has been approved for emergency authorization use by FDA. The monoclonal antibody that was used is a very safe class of drugs. I have worked on it in the past for Ebola. We were very successful in creating something that was really remarkable. Now, I believe that this cocktail uses two or more lab-engineered antibodies that go inside the body and target the spike protein the virus uses to kind of drill into the healthy cell, right? And another antibody that targets a different part of the coronavirus. And what they do is what we hope that they do is to wrap and shut down the viral replication. That means that the virus does not allow the virus to multiply. So that is what the mechanism of this monoclonal cocktail antibody is. It was tested about 275 people. A study has shown some really good results, but bigger studies need to be done. so far, it does not look like it is causing any type of adverse effects in the individuals that it was tested in. It was, of course, given to the president. From a scientific perspective, I have to tell you that with all the different things that the president received, I don't know if this is the drug that actually made the difference, okay? The president might have had a mild form of the disease and compared to other people. So we really don't know. But it seems as if this is not a bad treatment modality that is being developed. We need to do more studies. The problem with this drug is that the cost is very high, and only they have only manufactured so far or 50,000 doses are 50,000 doses are available essentially, and by the end of this next month they will have about 300,000 doses, but we need a lot more of it, and then the cost associated with it. So all those things have to be considered, and FDA is going to take a very serious look at the safety of the drug based upon the data that is published, as well as some of the data that it probably is not published as yet, mm-hmm. and the company has. So we'll see how that goes. But it does give us a ray of hope that there is something else apart from everything that we have in the toolbox against coronavirus that we can potentially develop and use.
What about, though, this idea that the study was relatively small, 275 people you mentioned. Do we know enough about it? Do we know enough about the risks and the effectiveness of it?
So in a small study, it's very difficult to learn about all the risks associated or the benefits associated with the drug, right? We saw that in hydroxychloroquine, small studies, people getting excited and jumping the gun. But this time around, I'm pretty sure that FDA is going to take a much, much deeper look at this particular a monoclonal antibody cocktail and come up with a conclusion whether to give it emergency authorization use or not. Because as you and I and everybody that's watching the show knows, that all the drug companies as well as the NIH, FDA, et cetera, all the organizations that are responsible for doing this have signed a pledge and said that unless and until something is safe and efficacious or effective, we are just not going to give it FDA approval, whether it's a vaccine, whether it's a therapeutic. So I believe in the science, and I believe in the scientists that are looking at it, that they'll make a very good decision if they certainly feel that this monoclonal antibody cocktail is useful. Then they will definitely give it emergency authorization use. President Trump probably was not the only one that got to use this medication as compassionate use. There have been other requests that have been made to the company for compassionate use, and they've provided this drug to others also.
Okay, we will just have to wait and see what the FDA ultimately concludes. Doctor, though, how are things looking when it comes to the overall fight against the coronavirus? Number of cases, for example, here in California, things continue to look pretty good. We have more and more counties moving into that next level on our state's reopening list. So how are things looking, and what are the areas that are still of most concern to you?
So for California, it's pretty good news. Things are moving in the right direction. But let me say that in US, there are about 7.8 million cases and approximately 215,000 deaths right now. And we are seeing about 45,000 cases every single day. Now, if that trend continues, right, if we keep seeing that number of cases, right now we are at 7.8 million cases. By the end of the year, in December, December 30th, we might have over 10 million cases in the country. That, if we keep the number of cases, the average at 45,000. Now, if the numbers go up, we are going to be in big trouble. Now, we are seeing that the deaths have gone down and plateaued, and we're seeing about 550 deaths per day. That means that if that trend continues, we'll have over 52,000 deaths additional deaths by the end of the year. That means 275,000 total deaths by the end of the year. That all takes into consideration, those numbers take into consideration that we stay at the same level that we are today. Now, remember in June of this year, we were at 25,000 cases per day. And then in July, when we peaked, we went up to 78,000 cases per day. That is about a 50,000 increase cases per day. if the same thing, God forbid, happens during November timeframe, and we go from 45 and add 50 more thousand cases per day, we are going to talk about 100,000 cases per day, which is going to be very difficult. Our baseline nationwide essentially is not low enough to make, you know, to say that everything is going to be okay. We have to be very stringent in terms of the precautions that we are taking. You know, even with remdesivir, even with the monoclonal antibody, even with everything that is out, dexamethasone, you know, right now those drugs are not available to the general population, won't be available to the general population. So what are we going to do? We don't have a vaccine. Hopefully we'll get a vaccine soon. But till that day, what we've got to do is we got to make sure that we do the common sense protective measures that we are doing, so that the number of cases does not increase, because if the number of cases keep on going up, the deaths are going to follow in 2 weeks. And we just don't want to go into that and have a ton of people, unfortunately, not be with us, during the holiday season.
Yeah, that's obviously the outcome that no one wants. We spent some time here, Doctor, recently talking about the sort of collision of the pandemic and the flu season. And we've talked about the importance of people going out and getting that flu vaccine. But I'm wondering how effective the flu vaccine might be in helping someone not get COVID-19, meaning will the vaccine boost my immunity that may prevent me from getting the coronavirus? And does it matter if I actually get a flu vaccine via an injection or the nasal spray?
So there are different types of flu vaccines. First of all, anybody who's listening to us, watching us, I want them to really, really go out and get the flu vaccine, because irrespective of anything else, you know, the more people who get flu vaccine, the less flu we have in the community and decrease the burden. So if the COVID burden increases, the hospitals and the healthcare system can manage all of that. Now, some recent studies that have been done by immunologists, they've looked at it, and what they're saying is that taking a flu vaccine, specifically the one that is the nasal spray, which has a live attenuated vaccine, what we call a live attenuated vaccine is, we don't kill the vaccine. Let me give you a parallel. A fly, you've clipped off the wings of the fly. So when it goes in the body, it is not going to cause the disease, but it's going to elicit an immune response that is good for you for not contracting the virus. Now, some of the immunologists and some of the studies have said that taking one vaccine, when it increases the immune response, will also help in developing a good immune response against other respiratory infections. No one believes that the protection will be very strong, or it will last long, but you know, it doesn't look like it is going to hurt anybody. It might help, on the other hand. And the nasal spray flu mist is an approved product for anybody between the ages of 2 to 49, not the senior citizens, but that age group. Mm-hmm. And we want to make sure that those people are protected against the flu. And at the same time, if it enhances the immune response to fight other respiratory diseases, then it's always going to be a good thing. We'll have to learn a lot more, but the basic information that we have based upon some of the data that people have collected on BCG, other vaccines that have been given around the world, it seems like getting one type of vaccine, which is a live attenuated vaccine, will help enhance immunity against other respiratory viruses.
Yeah, so perhaps that will encourage others to go ahead and get that flu vaccine now. Dr. Chotani, always a pleasure. I know that you like to leave us with the final thought, so go ahead.
So the final thought is the same. Use the mask, social distancing, and hand hygiene. We do not want our family not to be with us during the holiday season. Those are the three measures that we have that we can use, because we cannot get access to everything else that is out there because it's in limited quantity and we don't have a vaccine, and hopefully we'll have a vaccine. But let's make sure that we are happy during the holidays rather than being sad. So use precaution, and thank you so much.
All right, Dr. Chotani, always a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.